Welcome to this video on how do I get started with PowerShell for Microsoft Dynamics NAV 2013 R2. I'm Waldo, a Dynamics NAV MVP, and I'm creating this video in collaboration with Platan. At the end of this video, you will be more familiar on how to use PowerShell commandlets and where it can be used for Dynamics NAV. So the objectives are, first of all, tell you something about the tooling and how the tooling can be used, and some tips and tricks there, and also discovering the commandlets and use them. And we'll do that in four steps. First of all, we'll drill into the tooling, which tools can be used when you want to use PowerShell. Second, we'll go and drill into the commandlets. Where are the commandlets and how to get some help on it? Next, we'll combine commandlets by using piping. And finally, we'll end with some useful commandlets with some tips and tricks on combination of commandlets and all that. So which tools do we use when using PowerShell? Now, the first tool that most of the people are using is the PowerShell console. You can find the PowerShell console just by searching for it, which is this one, the Windows PowerShell. Or in the taskbar, you can find it as well. Now, you should always start PowerShell as an administrator. You obviously are administering stuff. We do that by clicking the right mouse click and then run as an administrator. And this should look kind of familiar. Like this is like an MS-DOS box, but it is not. But it gives you the same feeling as an MS-DOS box. And that's how PowerShell is used, by just putting in a lot of commands, which are actually called commandlets, which are doing what you want to do at that moment with PowerShell. Like, for instance, I want to have a list of all the services where the name NAV comes in. Then I've got a commandlet called getService. And I can provide a filter being NAV, and this is giving me a list with all the services with the name NAV. So very simple, commandlet and output. Now for scripting, there is the ISE, which stands for the Integrated Scripting Environment. Now you can start the ISE with that button on the taskbar as well. Push the right mouse button. You see the Windows PowerShell ISE. Now also this tool should be run as an administrator, so you should be using this one. And here you see that you get a user interface around your console window. The console window is still there and you can use it still as a console. So if I put in the same commandlet, I get the same output. But in top, you can do some scripting. This is the scripting window, some kind of notepad where you can put in a lot of commandlets and combine commandlets, loop stuff, and all those things. Now these scripts can be saved for later use. Now what this environment also brings is a very useful thing being called IntelliSense. When I, for instance, use the get, I get some kind of IntelliSense, all the get statements that are there for me. And the further I type, the further these statements are filtered. So I got my get service window, and as you can see on the right, there is some kind of help in the parameters that I can use for this commandlet. IntelliSense is very useful. Using the ISE for IntelliSense actually already makes sense. Now, as said, I can use it here as well. So I can put out a number of commandlets. Let's say I want to have the NAV, and I also want to have all the ones that with NetTCP, and then this is my script, for instance. I can execute this script or press F5. And this is giving me now a list of the services where the name NAV is in and also the NetTCP. Now there's also a very interesting shortcut being F8, and it is the run selection. Like if I only want to execute this command, I can select it. If I would press F5 or run script, it would just run the entire script. But if I press F8 or run selection, it will only execute the statements that I have selected. So in this case, the get service NetTCP. Now, when using PowerShell, it's not always clear which parameters are there, how to use these kinds of commandlets, which commandlets are there. And for that case, it would be nice to search. And in this PowerShell ISE, you've got the command window where you can do that. Like if I want to search for all service commands, you'll see that these are my commandlets. And if you want to know more about them, you can click it, like get service, and you see which parameters you can provide as well. And even you can fill them in here and run the command from here. So it's a very useful way for getting you familiar with the commandlets. Now, when you still need more help, there's always the F1. So for instance, when I select a command like this, just press F1 and I will get the help of that commandlet. Now, the last tip that I would like to show you here is that the ISE also provides you a way to use code snippets. You can do that by pressing Edit, Start Snippets, or the Control plus J. Like if I press Control J, I get a list of snippets that I can use. Something that is used a lot is the for each, for instance. And as you can see, it's going to provide me some code already so that I don't have to type too much. This is very useful when you do scripting. Now, during this video, we will be using the ISE all the time. But there is one other PowerShell window that we can use that actually comes with installing Dynamics NAV. The Microsoft Dynamics NAV 2013 R2 Administration Shell. Now again, I right click and I run this as an administrator. And as you can see, it's already doing kind of a lot of things. It is loading already a module that I will need, in fact, to use the Dynamics NAV commandlets. This module is not loaded when I start the PowerShell ISE or the default PowerShell console. It is only loaded when you start it with that shortcut. So maybe let's see how that shortcut works. As you can see, it's starting the PowerShell with a no exit, which means does not close this console, but keep it open. It's setting the execution policy to remote signed, and it's running a PowerShell script. So it's preparing my PowerShell environment for doing NAV commandlets. Now, I'm a fan of using the ISE, but for be able to use ISE with Dynamics NAV, I'll have to do kind of like the same things. So to be able to do this, I have to run some things in my ISE. Namely, as I said, I have to set my execution policy, and there is a commandlet for that, set execution policy, and I have to put it remote signed. And I have to import a module, the same module that shortcut was importing. So if I execute this, you see that the output is kind of like the same when I start the console for nav. And from now on, I've got my NAV commandlets available for me. So if I refresh the commands window and I filter for nav, you'll see that all my nav commandlets are available here as well. And I can click on it and see what the parameters are and go on with that. Also, my IntelliSense is updated. Like get nav service instance is available in my IntelliSense, and also the F1, the help, is updated as well. So now I have prepared my ISE. I've started it as an administrator. I've prepared it for the nav commandlets. So now I'm able to start doing nav administration with PowerShell, with my favorite tool being the integrated scripting environment. That gives us an idea on which tools are out there that helps us using PowerShell. And I think we all agree that the ISE is helping us the most. Now for the second step, I think I covered that quite a lot already. But let's go into that again by using an example. I, for instance, want to know about all the nav commands. Now, I know there is a get command commandlet, but I don't know how to use this. So the first thing I do is press F1. And I immediately saw that pressing F1 is actually executing a commandlet itself. Get help with some kind of commandlet and the show window. So maybe if I'm typing somewhere and I want something, then I can use this as well for getting the same result. A window with the help command. So this is the help of the get command. And I can read through this, getting me familiar with the get command. And what I notice maybe is that I can provide a module. Now I know that I loaded a module for getting all the nav commandlets. So maybe it's able to get all the commands from that module. So let me start by doing this. To get it easy, I just type the get command here in my command window. I find the module parameter and I try to put a module here. But I would know what to put here. So I want to have my IntelliSense here helping me. Now, the command window is not something where you can use IntelliSense, so I'm not able to use it here. So let me use the scripting window. Get command, I want a module. And now I know it's a module from Microsoft, so let me put in Microsoft and hope that IntelliSense is going to help me on that. It still doesn't. Now to force IntelliSense, you can press Control Space. And as you can see, I get a list of all the modules that are available now, and probably I want a module from nav. So I take that one and I press F5 to execute this command. Now I notice there is a get nav server instance. So I just click on it and press F1. And then I immediately get the help on that. No, this was not the one that I was searching for. I was actually searching for the nav tenant. So I click that one, I get the help here as well. Now, this seems more like the information that I needed. So I want to use this get nav tenant, but I wouldn't know how to use it. So I'm using my command window for that. I click on the get nav tenant and I see that I have to provide my services instance. This should give me all the tenants, I guess. So I copy the statement that I just created and I want to paste it here. I select it and I execute this. And here are all my tenants and the information of the tenants that I requested for. We spent quite a lot of time on how to get information, how to get help, and which tools to use. But obviously, it's important for you to be very efficient in this. To be even more efficient, you can use piping in your commandlets. And let's talk a little bit more about that. Now, when using PowerShell, you should think a little bit object-oriented. Like, all statements you execute gives back an object. If I execute get nav server instance, it's giving me back an object with the nav server instance. And an object has got properties. And these properties, an object you can use in other commandlets. Like, for instance, if I have the get nav tenant, I actually need the server instance. So how do I get the result, for instance, of this commandlet into this commandlet? That's by using piping. And when using piping, we obviously mean the pipe symbol. So if I, for instance, execute this, I'm actually saying, okay, I've got here a server instance. I already know what the output is, because when I press F8, then you see that I've got one service instance. I don't want to have that as a source for the get nav tenant. So in a way, I'm saying here, get me all the tenants of this server instance. And execute this, you'll see that it actually works. Get nav tenant is not asking me to provide a server instance. I did that by piping. Now, about all nav commandlets needs the nav server instance. And this is a way to get the current server instance of your current server piped into all your other commandlets. Like if I want to get all permissions, like get me all the nav permission sets, is kind of like the same. Get me all the permission sets of that server instance. Now do know if I've got more than one server instance installed on this server, this will actually execute the nav server permission set for all the server instances on this server. So now we know what piping can do for us. Let's see what other commandlets are useful for us and how we can use them. First, the where object. Like, I've got a huge result set of some kind of combination of commandlets, and I want to filter on them. With the where object, I can do that. Like here, you can see that I'm using the where object commandlet, and I provide some kind of filter. Now, the dollar underscore is actually the current pipeline object. So the current pipeline object in this case is the get nav server permission set. That object has got a permission set ID property, And I want to filter that one on all the ones that starts with super. And here you go, I've got two permission sets being super and super navi pane. The where object can be used on all kinds of objects. For instance, when I want to have all the nav tenants of a certain server instance, I get all the nav tenants, but maybe I want to filter them on a certain name, I can use the where object. Now in this case, the current pipeline object, the dollar underscore, is the nav tenant. The nav tenant has got a property called ID, and I want to filter the ID on, for instance, Platan. And when I execute this, I only get one tenant, the Platan. So for filtering the where object, it's a very good command to use. Now, when filtered, the object is still the same. So in this case, I've got still my tenant as being the current object. So I can do some further piping with this. Like I know I've got my Platan tenant and I want to dismount it. In this case, I can use the dismount nav tenant. I don't have to provide anything anymore because the object is already there. I've got the Platan object in this case. So executing this will ask me, okay, do you want to dismount the Platan tenant? Yes. And in this case, Platan is being dismounted. Now, in some cases, you really get an unuseful output. Like, for instance, if I want to see all the permissions for a certain service instance, you'll see that it's a huge output. And reading this through in this way is just not convenient. There are a few things that can help you with that. First of all, this would be easy to read if it would be formatted as a table. And now there actually is a commandlet for that, like format table. If I run this, the entire output is put as a table. But still, this is quite a lot of output. In fact, maybe I would like to know how many rows there are as an output. And for that, we've got the measure object. So let me execute that. So it would give me 4,600 lines. This is a lot. This is actually something that I would like to have in some kind of Excel file. So maybe if I can export this as a CSV, that would be more convenient. And we do that by not formatting it as a table, but actually exporting it to a CSV. And we just provide the file name, like export CSV, and run that. It seemed to have worked, so let's check that. This is actually a very readable format, and I can actually work with it. I can filter it in Excel, I can work with Excel. And let's go back to the format table option. Now the format table is giving me, in this case, a lot of columns, and maybe I'm not interested in all the columns. So how can I select the columns that I want? We do that with the select object. And the select object needs a property, and the property means the columns that I want. Like, I would like to have the object type, the object ID, and the read permission. If I run this and I format it as a table, you'll see that I only get those columns. Now I'm still not happy with the formatting, and the auto size is going to help me in that. So it's going to auto size now my columns for me. And here you go, I've got my three columns thanks to the select object. So this concludes the four steps. We talked about the tools, which tools can be used for PowerShell. We talked about how to find and getting help on the commandlets. We talked about piping, and we actually used the piping in some other useful commandlets. Now, to end with, I would like to refer you to the TechNet documentation from Microsoft that also has a complete chapter on getting you familiar with PowerShell. It's definitely worth to check it out. And for now, that was my resume on getting you started. I hope you enjoyed it, and see you next time.